Good morning and welcome to worship this morning as we gather to celebrate God in the midst of our life. Please remember to have communion ready during that portion of the service. Also, in the link that was sent in our previous text is a link to our website where if you are able to donate through our online giving. We continue with the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, the one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundance of God's grace. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our lives. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and our broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone, even before the words are on our tongues. You know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven in the wake of God's forgiveness. We are called to be the beloved community living out Christ's judgment, the Spirit reconciling peace. Amen. Our gathering hymn is one of many favorites, or one that you have sung when you were little. It's This Little Light of Mine, number 677. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and all for all who offer here their worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen, amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
No.
A reading from 1 Samuel. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel," and he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house, from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli, but Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. A reading from 1 Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, "The two shall be one flesh." But anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to John, the second chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Aaron came running into the kitchen. "Mommy, come see." Aaron's mother immediately dropped what she was doing and witnessed Joey's latest discovery on his backyard. Aaron had created this new person of Joey and this backyard safari that Aaron wanted his mother to see. Monique rushed back to her trailer, waiting for her father, saying, "Daddy, Daddy, come and see this amazing waterfall. Come and see it right now." Her dad breathed deeply and chuckled, "Give me a minute. Let me catch my breath. I'm not as young as I used to be." Monique sat patiently beside her father waiting. Finally, he took her by the hand and nodded, and she danced for joy when they came and they saw this waterfall. Come and see. Children do it all the time, at least young children, and even your grandchildren do it. They've discovered something new in their lives and they want you to come and see the joy. Come and see what's happening, because it's very new for them. It's exciting to their life. In 2016, I was invited to come and see, through our global mission partners, an event in Texas and in Mexico, the Mexican border, about how the ELCA was working with others and how we can do better. At that time, I was serving in a bivocational, as a bivocational pastor, which means I had a church and a secular job. I was able to go and see the ministries that were being carried out across the border on behalf of children. And not only seeing the ministries, but understanding how the Mexican culture works. Mexico is not very far from Nevada or Arizona or even California. And my secular job was teaching. During that time, I had a young child in my class who would not read. She refused to even open a book at times. I didn't know why. Then one day she told me, "My dad takes me to Mexico every weekend." So in 2016, hearing this group of people and understanding that girls are not valued and not encouraged to read by their fathers, hit a light bulb with me, that come and see aha moment. Well, no wonder she's not reading. She's not encouraged at home. You have to approach it in different ways. You have to look at it differently. I looked at it differently, and this child began to read. She began to understand the English language and to understand what she was reading. That aha, clear moment. that come and see moment that we all have in our lives at one time or another. This passage that we are given from John is called us to come and see. Jesus is not going to wait for people. He's going out to find the people, to share the message. Jesus decides to go to Galilee and find Philip. In the unknown if Jesus really knew Philip at that time, but perhaps Jesus went looking for him on recommendations of Andrew and Peter. They were all from the same hometown. It's possible that there was no previous connection, but we don't really know that. The key to this story is inviting. Inviting people to hear God's message. When Jesus finds Philip, he simply invites him by saying, "Follow me." There is no mandate. There is no theological discourse or theological realms for it. It's simply an invitation to follow me. If Philip responded verbally to Jesus' invitation to follow him, it was not recorded in our gospel today. Yet it must have been a resounding yes, because Philip leaves and finds Jesus and other seekers, such as Nathanael. Jesus' actions spark a chain of reaction. Jesus invites Philip, only to have Philip invite Nathanael. Today, we might call this building relationships. Some theologians might call it relational evangelism. But it's sharing the good news of Jesus from one person to another person to another person to another person. Philip and Nathanael are educated men who are well-versed in the law of the prophets, both known of the promise of the Messiah, both anticipated and sent by God. Yet Nathanael is doubtful when Philip announces that he has found the one who he has been seeking. Nathanael points out to the obvious. What good could ever come from Nazareth, a town known for not much of anything? When I hear this passage, I always think of the title of Sin City, the campaign that was given to Las Vegas. What good could come from Las Vegas, where I grew up? What good could come from those places which have been described as no good? But Philip invites Nathanael to simply come and see. There's no need to debate. It's just come and see what's going on. See who Jesus is for yourself. Jesus knows that Nathanael will follow and that Nathanael is baffled. Jesus answers Nathanael's being amazed and not understanding by saying, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Jesus' answer can easily be baffling. But a fig tree is isolated, making it impossible for anyone to know he was there. Some believe that the fig tree is a symbol for the study of Scripture. Perhaps Nathanael had studied the Scripture in secret with Philip. Nevertheless, they click and they are called to come and see. In 1955, people were invited to come and see and to start a church. They were invited to come and start something new. If 1955 doesn't ring a bell for you, that's when this congregation was started. Someone invited someone and invited someone else and invited someone else until we are here today. In 1955, someone said, "Come and hear and see the good news of Jesus. Come and take a risk to see. Come and change the world." Are we still changing the world? Are we changing how we invite people to come and see? Are we meeting people where they're at so that they can come and see the good news of Jesus? Are we taking the risk for the sake of the gospel so people can know God's love? In 1955, people were coming and seeing. They changed. They became the church. Not the church we know today, because the church is radically changing. We change how we do things because circumstances in our society. Things happen that are unexpected. Many of you, I know, want to be back in these pews, but circumstances does not allow that at this time. It changes how we do church in 2021. It changes how we think and how we share God's message with others. This week, I was a little disappointed. I put a post on our Facebook page, said, "How are you sharing God's love?" No one responded with any comments. It reached about 60 people, yet no one responded with how they were sharing God's love. So it also got me to thinking, maybe you need examples of how to share God's love in the midst of a pandemic, about how to invite people to come and see. The best thing to do right now is a phone call to a friend, inviting them to maybe check out our website or our Facebook page or our YouTube channel to see what we're up to. Maybe it's calling a friend who just needs someone to listen. That's sharing God's love. Maybe it means writing a note to a friend or a loved one. Circumstances don't allow us to be together, and that does hinder sharing God's love. But really, it also makes us want to share God's love more. We share God's love when we donate to food drives, when we donate to our preschool, when we help those in need, whatever organization it is for you. That's sharing God's love. That's inviting people to come and see. Come and see this good news in the midst of the world that's pretty much gone to chaos for some people. In a world where we don't know what to think or what to do, we come and we see here God's love. We experience that grace and forgiveness in the midst of a world that stresses us out, that makes us feel alone. And we invite people into that world because we know God is love. God loves us no matter where we are, no matter who we look like, no matter what we do. The world tells us otherwise. The church tells us that God is love. Jesus invites Philip to follow him. Philip responds favorably and extends that invitation to Nathanael. The invitation is met with doubt and skepticism at times. But then Nathanael realizes that Jesus is the Messiah, the one who is called to be worthy of being followed. As a disciple of Jesus, we are called to have an attitude of inviting others to come and see and to receive God's grace in your life. Why are you hesitant sometimes to receive that grace? Because God comes to us in many different ways. If we limit those ways, we limit God. God comes to us in the breaking of the bread as we gather distantly. God has come through phone calls and prayers with others during this time for me. God comes when I stand around this altar and I feel the presence of all of your names around the altar. Yes, you may not be here physically, but you are here in spirit. God's presence is right here, right now. So are you willing to come and see? Amen. Our hymn of the day is Here I Am, Lord, number 574. Confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all those in need. For the body of Christ gathered throughout the world, and for your servants of the gospel that follow Jesus, the church lives out its calling every day. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the well-being of creation, for plants and animals, for all that God has marvelously made, that we serve as wise and stewards of this earth that we call our home, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For police officers and firefighters, for attorneys and paralegals, for peacemakers and military personnel, for all the leaders of governments, that they provide protection to all people, especially the most vulnerable in this world. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those who lack food or shelter, for those who are sick or grieving, for those who are imprisoned or homebound, for those in the midst of our congregation who need your extra care, Lord God, hear us. Be with Jean and Robert, Heather, Helen, Janet, Debbie, Kate, Jean, Marge, Wes, Lance, Bob, Kristen, Rebecca, Greg, Jerry, Evelyn, Joyce, and Bob and Dorothy. Lord, guide our bishops, Elizabeth Eaton and Andrew Taylor. Be with all those families affected by COVID-19. Be with our firefighters, and police officers as they battle the rage among their professions. Be with those who serve on front lines of our nursing homes and hospitals in these uncertain times. We pray for all our military chaplains and others serving around the world and in our country in the military, that God will console each who are in suffer or in need and who are service to all who lead us. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For our neighborhoods, for visitors joining us for the first time or returning, for the sake of those who are absent in this assembly, that we who seek to know God may be nourished by word and sacrament. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for all the saints who have gone before us, we lift up Carol as her family mourns her death, as she now resides with all the saints and the vision of the gospel in action. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share that peace with those in your household. If alone, share that with a friend this afternoon. We are sharing this peace and love through different medias. We thank you for the gifts of offering that you have continued to give to our Saviors. There's been a link placed on our YouTube page for digital donations or online donations. And we thank you for supporting this ministry as we share the gospel. At this time, I invite you to have your communion ready. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and always. Amen. Let us pray. Christ Jesus, at this table we are fed on your very life and are strengthened for our journey. Send forth from this banquet, nourished by the body and in the spirit, to proclaim your good news and serve others in your name. Amen. As you go into your week, go knowing that Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, King of all creation, will go before you to lead you the way of your life. He will be on your right side and your left as friend, advocate, companion. He will be above you, watching over you, and below you, lifting you up, giving you all that is needful, grace sufficient for the challenges of each day, the fruits of the Holy Spirit. He will be behind you, encouraging you on those difficult and challenging places and relationships and the very real obstacles and mazes that you face in your life. So as you go into this week, go knowing that Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, will be around you and in you until we gather as God's loving, serving, joyful people. Amen. Our ascending hymn is Songs of Thankfulness and Praise, number 310.
At Cana wedding guest.
Go in peace to shine and share the light of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.